One of each data like a boss? If so, this video is perfect for you. We'll use React, Fetch, useEffect, Suspense, and other techniques to implement data fetch using different approaches. In this video, we'll cover some theoretical parts first, and then jump into solving a task from the 30 days of React.js challenge. Our task might have a different user interface, and we'll skip some steps. But by the end, you will know exactly how to fetch data in React.js. Let's start by understanding the useEffect hook. It's a powerful tool in React that accepts two arguments. The first argument is a function, and it gets executed after the component renders for the first time, and after every re-render. If that function returns another function, it will be executed when the component is about to unmount, or when the dependencies change before the next effect execution. The second argument is optional array of dependencies. It controls when the effect function should be re-executed. To make the effect run only once after the initial render, you can pass an empty array. If you omit the second argument, the effect will run after every render of the component. Now, here is an essential rule for the second argument. If any variable used inside the useEffect hook is defined outside of it, then that variable should go in the dependency array. This ensures that the effect will be executed whenever any of the items in the dependency array change. One more time, useEffect with empty array as the second argument runs after the initial render only. useEffect without a second argument runs after every render or update. useEffect with dependencies as a second argument runs after the initial render and whenever any of the items in the dependencies change. If useEffect returns a function, the return function is a lineup function. It returns when the component unmounts or before the next effect execution, when the dependencies change. Before we dive into today's task, let's take a look at the problem we will be solving. Our goal is to fetch data and determine the average metric weight and lifespan of ads using a specific API that provides an array of objects. Each object in the array represents information about an ad, including its name, description, and other fields. For displaying the ad's picture, name, and description, we'll utilize the image field. And to allocate the weight and lifespan, we'll be using the corresponding weight and lifespan fields. The rest of the fields will be ignored for simplicity in this video. To save time and streamline our UI development, we'll leverage Material UI to build our UI components. Specifically, we'll use list and list items to represent the list of ads. Additionally, we'll explore some experimental React features to introduce you to the latest trends in React development. Let's get started and have some fun with ads and React. I want to share with you the files we'll be working with. We have a file named v1, which represents the first version of our task. Additionally, there is a media list component that we won't touch, as it already provides the UI for our page. The component displays the average information for ad weight and lifespan. To allocate this information, I've been created a helper function that iterates through our data array, sums up the relevant information, and then divides it by the total amount of entries. We won't be diving into the details of these files anymore, as our focus will be on the main file. In the first version of our implementation, we'll be using fetch useState and useEffect to fetch data. Let's import useState and useEffect. Then, start by creating a variable for our URL with the API address provided in the task. It's a good idea to store similar constants in a separate file, but since we have only one endpoint, we'll keep it simple for now. Next, let's create a function called getData, which will receive a query, in this case breeds, and handle it with tryEdge. In the edge block, we'll throw an error, throw new error, and then let's write some error fetching data message and also add our error. In the Tribler, we'll fetch data using the URL and query that the function receives. We'll then wait for the response JSON and return the JSON data variable. So let's write our variable, let's write it, and let's return our JSON data. Now let's set up our state using useState, where the default value will be an empty array which the MediaList component will receive. Let's write useState with empty array and pass it to our MediaList as a props. The last step in this version is to use useEffect. We'll pass in two arguments, a function and empty array. This empty array ensures that we fetch data only after the initial render. Inside the useEffect, we'll also get data function with reads as the argument. Since getData returns a promise, we need to use then function to save the data into our state. As you can see, we now have all the data we need. As you can see, all data is presented on the screen. Everything looks good. For the second version, we'll switch from using fetch to Axios. The only change we need to make here is to remove the response JSON all, since Axios automatically parses JSON responses. This is the only difference for this particular task between using fetch and Axios. Of course, there are more differences between these two, but for now we'll focus on this one change. While we wait for data to be fetched, we want to display a placeholder. For this purpose, we'll use a skeleton component from Material UI. Now let's move on the third version, which includes the first version's functionality along with a loading state. So let's write our variables and set false as a default value. Next, we'll add if statement to check if we are waiting for data. If that's the case, we'll show the skeleton component as a placeholder. Let's add true as a loading state, and you can see the placeholder instead of the actual data while it's been fetched. Now we need to update our useEffect function. Instead of just using then to handle the data, we'll use a finally method, which means that the promise is settled. In the finally block, we'll set loading to false to change our layout. Let's refresh a page a few times just to check if everything works. As a demo, I will add a setTimeout function, which will introduce an artificial delay. This way, you can see how it works when there is a big delay in fetching the data. However, I must emphasize that in real-life scenarios, it's not recommended to postpone receiving data like this. Let's explore how to use Suspense and React to improve our data fetching and loading experience. Suspense allows React to display a loading fallback until all the code and data needed by the children components have been loaded. However, there is one important thing to note. Suspense doesn't detect when data is fetched inside effect or event handler. To handle data fetching in this scenario, we'll use the use function. It involves using promises on the root level of our application. So let's write the final version. First, let's remove the useEffect and useState from our project. Instead, we'll import Suspense and use from React. Then we'll wrap our list component with Suspense and use the skeleton component as a fallback. So let's write it, and don't forget to put our list as a child. The last step is to receive data for our list. We'll create a variable and use the use function passing getData as a result. That's all we need to do to receive and represent data. With this approach, we no longer need to use useEffect and useState for fetching data. Now let's open our page in a new window to check if everything looks good. And it looks. If you find this video helpful, please don't forget to like it and subscribe to my channel for more useful content. Thank you for watching.